Next step is, okay, we have a mesh. How does this mesh react on a load? Reaction, it means like what properties do we have? And property means like which is the material we are using here. As you remember from last week, it's material steel. So we just can go here to the model area or model ribbon, go to click here on materials. This create materials window will open. We say, okay, we want to define a material with a specific name. I name it material steel. Press enter. ID can be one, color can be this. Cut image is again MUT1, so the linear temperature independent isotropic material. Then E-modulus was 210,000 megapascal. Poisson's ratio was 0.3 and rho density, as I said, in linear static analysis, we don't need this. But yeah, we can just define it to just to show again to you that it's important if you want your stress results in megapascals and you're using a unit system of millimeter tons and seconds, that you have to define your density in tons per cubic millimeters in order to get the stress result in megapascal. I just can repeat this every time because yeah, this should be in your mind. This should always be in your mind when you're using finite element. Yeah, when you're using finite elements, you can click on close. After defining a material, we just have to create a property to, in order to assign the material to the component. And property creation was done again here in model. Click here on this property ribbon. Again, this property creation window will open. We name it, we give it a nice name, prop SD shaft, for example. SD stands for solid. I usually name my name my properties like this so that I don't get confused with large models, for example. ID color and here card image is now the most important thing. We don't have P shell, we have P solid now because we have solid elements. P solid can be used for hexaeder elements, pentaeder elements, also for tetraeder elements. We have to define a material. You can just click here on material and on the three dots you can choose a material, or you just click on you just open the material browser and click here on matte steel, and you see that matte steel is then selected for you. You click here on OK, and that's it for property generation. You click on close. You can again close this material browser. You now have to go back to the component browser, select this hex shaft component, and here in this entity browser, you just have to assign the recently created property to this component. So property here, you can choose it, and with this advanced selection, you can just choose property SD shaft. Click OK. See, you can see that the material is automatically selected as matte steel. And a last check we should do is, for example, this one here. If you click here on compute areas, volumes, length, masses, and so on, you can use HyperWorks to create or to calculate the volume these elements are basically the volumes of these elements. That's how it should be. And with the volume, since we have defined a density to our material, you will also see a structural mass, for example. I choose this component here, click on compute, and you can see that we have a volume of 11,705 cubic millimeters and a mass of 9.19 to the power of minus 5 tons for exactly that's the mass of this of these elements. Okay, you also can see the center of gravity. This is of course not in our origin at x and y, because we only have a quarter model. If you would have the full model, of course the center of gravity would be x and y, at least would be at zero. Okay, just to check if everything, this tool is really useful if you want to check if everything was done right, if you have assigned the right material to your part. And if you have done this last check, we can directly go to, we can close this here, and we can head over to defining loads collectors and steps, and in the end then also output requests. Okay, let's go back to the mother browser. Like last week, we have to define boundary conditions and applied loads. Since we are using a symmetric, let's say it like this, since we want to use symmetric boundary conditions, we have to define a boundary condition on this whole face in the y direction, a boundary condition where we on this face here, so in x direction, and of course we have to constrain our part here so that we get the same problem as with the 1D FE model, so that this area here is constrained in all six directions. To create a load collector, we just said we have to right click in our model browser, say create load collector. I will call the first one BC X symmetry, and then I go here to analyze to BCs, and here on constraints I select one node here, select nodes then by face, and say okay, please constrain these nodes only in one direction, so in x direction, and I'm going to deselect the nodes at the end of the shaft because we will have boundary conditions here anyway. So this is in one direction, as you can see, x is going here in this direction, so the symmetrical boundary condition should be here. Create. Then I'm going to create a load collector. This is BC, in this case, y symmetry. And we constrain not DOF 1, we constrain DOF 2, again nodes by face, project overview again, deselect the end of the shaft and say create. And if you zoom in, you can see here this number 2, and if you click on here on this side and maybe use this wireframe, this transparency mode of elements, you can see that this node is constrained in direction 1. Since 3D elements don't have, or let's say like this, since 3D elements only have translational degrees of freedom and now rotational degrees of freedom, we don't have to constrain the rotational degrees of freedoms like DOF 4 to DOF 6. For 2D elements, this is different story. There you have to make sure that you also constrain your rotations. Okay, yeah. Now we have the two symmetric boundary conditions, and now I want to basically constrain all nodes here in all six directions. But as I said, solid elements don't have any rotational degrees of freedom, so I just have to define DOF 1 to DOF 3, click here on this node and say by face, and click create. Reject because I'm in the wrong load collector. I mean, you can define it also in this load collector, but I like to divide my load collectors. Following 1, 2, 3, and I just click here on node and say it by face and say create. Perfect. These are my boundary conditions. Now, if these triangles are too big for you, you can, for example, just change the relative size. This is just a visualization tool. You can change it and you can see that these triangles get smaller and the overview in this graphic area is better. I click on right and that's it with my boundary conditions. I click return. As you remember from last week maybe, is that we have to define a load step now, and in this load step we only can use one boundary, so one load collector which defines the boundary conditions. Since we have three load collectors now, we have to put all three load collectors in one load collector, which is summing up those three boundary conditions, and we are using the newly created load collector. It's the load collector with SPC add. So we will use this one to use it in our step definition. So I'll just create a new load collector and I say, okay, this is my BC add load collector. Here I have to change the card image from none to SPC add. SPC add, just to repeat this, SPC stands for single point constraints. And if we change this card image to SPC add, you can see that the load collector will be grouped now in under this SPC add card. And here we just have to define the number of load collectors which are included in this SPC add card. We say 3, and then we can choose our 3 load collectors by just putting them here in this table. Okay, we have 3-1 close. Okay, and this is our SPC add now. Now we have to define our force, and I said we have to define in our force, and as I said in the introduction, I would like to apply pressure now here. Exactly. We have a force of 10 kilonewtons and a cross-section area here. Let me just have a look. It should be 78.54 square millimeters because this is the diameter of 10 millimeters. If you do the math, you can calculate this cross-section. So if you divide this force, the 10,000 newtons, by the cross section 78.54, you will get a pressure you have to apply on this cross section here of 127.3 megapascals. Okay, this was done for the whole section now. Now we have a quarter section, so we have to divide the applied force by 4, but also the cross section by 4. And so the pressure will stay the same with 127.3 megapascal. To define pressure, we have to create a load collector again, create load collector. I call it load pressure 127 megapascal, for example. Give it a nice color. maybe some kind of orange or so. And then here in this analyze ribbon, you can use this load symbol and or load ribbon. And here in this load ribbon, you can just go to apply pressures. You will be directed to the pressure panel. And here you can create by using faces, for example. If you go with your mouse over this face, then this face will be selected. Or if you just want to use single elements, you can change here to elements, for example, at this second arrow. We want to use faces. I click on this face here. I say 127.3 megapascal pressure. And relative size is just again the visualization tool, and if I click on create and choose normal here, this pressure will be created. Perfect, yeah. Now we have everything defined for our load step, so I can close this panel and I go back to my model browser, right click on the model browser, say create and say load step. We call this step, we give it just a name, I call it step one. Analysis type, we again want to do linear static, single point constraint, there we have to choose boundary condition, BC add. Load, we want to choose our pressure. And that's it. We don't have any pretensions or we don't have multi-point constraints. That's it basically. If we go to output now, we can define our output data. So data which we want to have in our post-processing, let's say it like this. Usually you don't want to have every single output request because it takes time to calculate it, and it especially takes time to store it on your disk. So you just choose output requests you really want to have. In our case, I would like to have displacement output. And displacement output, you just tick here on displacement. Then I would like to have SPCF output. Where is it? It's the single point constraint forces. This we are going to use to check if our applied load is equal to the load of our support. I click here on SPCF, but I don't want to have a look at it in my post-processor. So I just can change the format from H3D. If you remember, maybe from last week, format H3D is used in Hyperview to open the results, and then you can have a look at plots or vectors. I want to request SPC forces as opti, and opti is just an SC file. So a text file you can open and directly see which single point constraint forces you have in your model. This file will be saved then in your folder where you do your calculation in. And last but not least, I want to have stress and strain results. Stress and strain results, I tick here location. I want to have it at the corner. So the reason for having stress and strain results at the corner is the following. Stresses are always numerically calculated at the integration points, IP. These points are here, 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 and here in the shell element, for example. In OptiStruct, by default, element stresses for shell and solid elements output at the element centroid only. So only one stress value for linear elements and at the centroid point. If you want to have stress output at the nodes, here, 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 so at the outer surface, for example, For solid elements, we have to extrapolate those values from the centroid. And this is usually, or in the simplest way, it's done by bilinear extrapolation. All right, knowing this and going back to HyperWorks, we just remember that we just requested corner data for strains, and so the next step is to create corner data for stresses as well. Corner. You can save the model, and I think basically for analysis this should be it. So let's go through it again. We have defined a finite element model with solid elements. We have deleted 2D elements so that we don't get any problems with properties which are not defined. We have created a material steel. We created a property. We assigned that property to, or we created a solid property. We assigned that solid property to the component hex shaft. We created boundary conditions for our model. We created a load for our model, and we created a subcase or a step for our model, and we requested results. Okay, basically that's it. So let's try to analyze it. We go to analyze ribbon, click here on this analyze play button. We will be directed to this analyze panel again. We have to choose a file where we want to save our simulation data in. I create a new folder and say, okay, please save it in Shaft. Double click and I call it Shaft and save. And after doing this, I go to export options. We want to export everything. Run options, we want to analyze. Memory options is default. And if you click on Optistruct, you see that the solver will start, and we see our progress soon here. If everything is going right, okay. We see again our maximum displacement here. We don't get any error messages. We see analysis completed. And if you hit close, you can go to the directory of your simulation. It's here. And there you can find this shaft.spc. You can double click on it and open it. And there you see the file. You have the node ID, then you have force in X direction, Y direction, and Z direction. You can go down. You can see you have here is the symmetric boundary condition in Y direction, for example. Here is a node with the boundary condition only in X direction. If you go completely down, you can see the sum. And there you can see that we have. In Z direction, a total force of 2,484 newtons. Since we have a quarter model, you have to multiply this by 4 at 3.5. When I do it on my calculator, I get a force of nearly 10,000 newtons. It's not equal to 10,000 newton because I did not round it to the last digit. I did not round the pressure, the applied pressure, to the last digit at the applied load. If you want to have exact 10k, you should do this then. This was just to show you how to check single point constraint forces. And since we are the analysis went through without any error messages, we can open HyperView have a look at these the results. I again open my hyperview with this double window here. I want to have two pages at in my graphic area basically. I just have to wait again 1 second and I click here. And by default, this will automatically be hyperview window. After a few seconds, we are there. Go here to results. And if I click now here on open, I can open the directory of my shaft, and this should be shaft 3D. Say apply, you can see that our model will be opened. I just rotate it in the right direction, something like this here. Exactly. Then I will just make the, I will maximize this window and show my elements. This is done by clicking here on mesh lines, and then we can see our complete model. Okay. Last week I just did the hyperview introduction really fast, and because of this I want to go a bit into detail today. Basically, the layout of hyperview is the same as in hyper mesh. We have here our title bar, and for example here in results, this is the ribbon we will use the most, or the ribbons we will use the most. We have here, for example, the table I showed you last week, where we can just by clicking on elements or nodes see results directly. On the side here, we have again our browser area with a result browser, for example. And result browser, we can choose our subcase, and we directly see which type of analysis was carried out. Here we have then our result browser. We have all the assemblies, for example. We have an hyper mesh. We also have here an hyper views. We can see our components. That's basically it. To request results, this area here is the most important one, especially here. Here you can project your view to top view, bottom view, like you know already. Here is this fit symbol again. Here we have a nice tool, this is section cuts, so you can create section cuts by just clicking on top of here. Say for example you want to add a section cut, you want to have it in direction of the y-axis, your base point, you can define it by just moving this bar here or by typing in the coordinates of this base point, and then you have this section cut shown here. You can of course define your own section planes, or you can use planes like for example here, set axis, apply, and then you have, you can go through your section cuts along the z axis. It's a really useful tool, maybe you can use it from time to time as I delete. The next one is, for now, it's this contour plot. Like last week, we can first of all say, okay, please show me result type displacement. And we have the option to say, okay, please show me the magnitude or the displacement in my directions. I say apply displacement magnitude. Here we can select and for which components basically, or for which elements I want to display my displacement or my contour plot. I can click here, for example, also on elements, so that I can only choose a few elements which should have a contour plot, and the other elements wouldn't have any color at all. Then this is possible resolved in. We have here analyzer system and global system. This is basically used for if you would have a local coordinate system, We will define local coordinate systems tomorrow in the composite training. But if you would have some, you would be able to choose it here and to display your results in a local coordinate system. Okay. What you also can have here is what you can change and yeah, what I usually change is legend. Here you can go to on edit legend and you will see that a window like this will open. I will just cancel this and put this a bit here so that we can see everything. Edit legend again, and then we can put the window here. Here you can basically set up your legend, the legend which was automatically created here. You can set up fixed scale, position, for example, upper left, interpolation is linear. I will leave it like this at the moment, but you also can define logarithmic interpolation. Numerical format, you can change it to fixed, for example, and you see that your format will be changed. Numerical precision, it's basically the number of digits you want to have in your model. I would go for 2, for example, for now. And number of levels is the number of colors basically you want to have here. I will go to 8 at the moment. And if you hit apply, you will see that the legend shown here automatically changes. Here in this legend, you also see maximum and minimum values at grid points. Grids are basically the nodes, and the 153 you can see here is a node ID. If you're not satisfied with the colors here, you can change the colors as well. For example, this dark blue one, you can just go here and say, okay, you want to have it gray, or you want to create your own color. Yeah. Say okay, hit apply, and you can see that the color of the dark blue region will change to gray. If you now want to fix some numbers here, for example, you have several load steps, and this number would change automatically depending on the minimum and the maximum displacement in this case, for example. If you would like to fix some numbers, you can just go here on the number and type in 0. And here, for example, type in 0.1. And to see that 0.1 is now written in bolded letters, and this value wouldn't change when you use this legend setup. It wouldn't change at all because it doesn't matter what subcase you choose here, then this 0.1 is fixed. Just for explanation. If you want to have your default values back, you can just click on default and on apply, and then you can set up everything again. I just leave it then the numbers default. I just wanted to show it to you that this is possible. Colors are fixed now, and now I can, for example, display strains or stresses. I will do it element stresses to the 3D. Last week with the 1D elements, we had element stresses 1D available. We can have a look at von Mises and hit apply, and you can see that we basically have two nominal stresses. And maybe back to this legend again, you can see that the lowest number is now 8.58. And if you want to fix this scale with 0, you just can go to edit legend and type in 0 here, and then apply and okay. You see now 0 is written here, and from 0 to 16.55 element stresses, you have this gray. If you want to request element stresses now, you can just make use of this table here and click here, for example, and somewhere here, for example. You will see that you have a nominal stress basically of this element of 31.82 and the nominal stress of this element over here of 127.3 megapascal. These are basically the values we have seen last week in our 1D mesh as well as in our manual calculation for this problem. The interesting part now is basically this region here. Of course, we haven't seen this last week since we used two elements last week, two 1D elements, and this, I would say, notch stress, because we have a notch here, we have a higher stress than, we have a higher stress than the nominal stresses. This is because of this change in stiffness, basically, because of this abrupt change in stiffness over here. And for example, here, this element still has this 126 megapascal, but this is for the whole element, as I said. And if you just rotate it a bit and clear this table and go back to this contour plot, and here you can use this corner data, what I explained before, that this element centroid stress will be extrapolated to the nodes out here, and apply. And if you use then an averaging method, for example, advanced, you can also apply, and then you can see here that are now able to make use of this table again, but instead of elements, you can use nodes, for example. And maybe you remember this element before has, or this element has a centroid stress of 126 megapascal, and here at this outer and where we are now on 141 megapascal. And as I said, this is because we have a stiffness, a notch here. If you want to lower the stresses here in this region, you have to optimize this part. I mean, there are, for example, the easiest way would be to put the radius in here, and the stress values would decrease a lot. If you want to know how to model a radius inside here so that you have a nice notch, I would invite you to have a look at this tutorial here. You can find it attached to, I think, in this in our chat today, and also soon attached on the webinar homepage. And also, on if you look for it in a searching machine, you will also be able to find it. It's from 2019, and it was written for the older HyperMesh version. But in principle, the modeling method is explained here for a shaft. For example, if you can see here, there's a radius, and I'm explaining in this tutorial how to model this radius in a how to model this radius properly, just as a hint. Good, yeah. Now we have this 3D example. We had to look at the nominal stresses. They are basically the same as in the 1D FE model, and of course also the same as in our hand calculation. But we saw that in this area of this notch we have a stress increasement, and this that's the reason usually, I mean, you know those parts, how they look like. They have a radius, for example, here, such as just an optimized shape. so that the stiffness increasement is not from immediately, so that we don't have immediate stiffness increasement, so that this stiffness increases slowly with this function here. Basically, that's all I want to tell you for now for this 3D model example. And the next thing would be optimization of optimization. I would like to invite you to show you to 3D topology optimization. It's a really helpful tool, and helpful, I mean, regarding load distribution and paths.